हेलो सर, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून। सो वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट आवर क्लास सून, बट बिफोर दैट लेट अस वेट फॉर 1 or 2 मिनट्स टू जॉइन अदर्स। विद इन 2 or 3 मिनट्स वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट आवर टुडेस क्लास।
ओके सर।
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. So let's start our today's session.
Assalamualaikum sir.
Waalaikum assalam. So in our today's class, we are going to discuss about some topics from CSE 104. That is computer fundamental lab course. So is this my voice is clear to you? Can you guys hear me clearly? Can you guys hear me clearly? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikum assalam. My voice is clear to you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right. In our previous lab class, we have selected 2 person as convener and reporter. So, if I'm not wrong, Tanvir is the convener, isn't it, for today's class?
No, sir.
Who's the convener?
Shubha was the convener.
Who was the convener and Tanvir was the reporter, or who was the reporter?
Yes, yes sir.
All right. Go, carry on.
Assalamualaikum. Very much sorry, sir, for background sound. Assalamualaikum. I am Shubha as a reporter. I honor you, and I want to call my name Tanvir Ahmed. Who is our reporter? So please, Tanvir.
I have a question, sir.
Please.
Sir, I thought I was the reporter of Saturday.
Okay.
But I didn't get my preparations.
Okay, but you joined the previous class, isn't it? Previous lab class. So what we discuss, what you recall? Just discuss about that thing, and if you need any help, I'm going to help you. No problem. Okay.
Okay, sir. In brief, thank you for giving me the chance to be the reporter of this class. In last Wednesday, the class summary was. We actually introduced with each other first sir, I totally forgot, sir. I'm missing
okay,
it.
Okay, okay, okay. No problem. Let me help you. So basically, in our previous class, as Tanvir already mentioned, we basically introduced with each other. I gave my introduction. You basically gave your introduction. And after that, I basically discussed about your course outline. Okay. Course outline of CSE 104. We discuss about the course code, course name, then the schedule of the course, objective of the course, aim of the course, then mark distribution of this course. Okay. And we discuss about some rules and regulation which you have to follow, which you have to obey in your graduation period. Okay. So these are the things mainly we discussed in our previous class. Okay. And okay, all right. So that's all about the previous class. So Shubho, carry on.
Thank you, Tanvir and our sir for helping him. Do you have any question about the previous class, guys?
Sir, can you go through the course outline once again, please, for CC104?
Okay, thank you. Dhruvo, sir will discuss about it. Please, sir.
Sir, we cannot hear you.
We cannot hear you, sir.
Sir, please unmute your microphone.
Okay, so I'm saying that give me some moment to open my slide. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I requested you to continue our class. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, convener. Thank you, reputier. So I have shared my slide with you. Let me know whether you can see it or not.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, we can see.
All right. So this is our actually course outline, okay? So CSE 104, this is the course code and fundamental of computers and applications lab. This is actually our course title, okay? And you know that we are in summer 2020 semester. For this course, you have basically 1 credit hour, okay? And for 1 credit hour lab, you have to spend 2 hours in a week with me. That means we have 2 classes, okay? Every Wednesday, we have 2 consecutive hours class, okay? And again, here you will get my contact detail, my email address, and my mobile number. Then we discuss about the course objective, basically what we are going to achieve after learning this course, after spending four months with this course. So you can develop your skill. That means how you can browse internet, how you can search something by using Google search engine. Then you will be able to develop your skill. That means how you can use email in a formal manner, how you can send, how you can receive, and how you can perform other operations on email. Then you are going to learn about different application software like Microsoft Office. Under Microsoft Office, we are going to learn about Microsoft Office Word. By using Microsoft Office Word, you will be able to compose any document. You are going to learn about Microsoft Office PowerPoint. By using Microsoft Office PowerPoint, you will be able to give or prepare your PowerPoint presentation. Then we're going to learn about Microsoft Office Excel. So you're going to learn how you can do different types of calculation by using Microsoft Office Excel. Okay, that is the thing. So these things are very important. That means why? Basically, during your graduation time period, for different courses, you have to prepare number of assignments. You have to prepare a number of reports. And you have to compose those reports. Okay, most of the time, you have to compose those report by using your computer. On that time, you should have some knowledge about that Microsoft Office Word. Okay. Then again, in different courses, you have to prepare number of presentation slides. Okay, on different topics. So that's why you need to know how we can prepare PowerPoint presentation by using this Microsoft Office PowerPoint. Then as well as when you would like to show some statistical information or mathematical calculation, on that time you need this Excel file. Okay, suppose in a presentation you would like to show a bar chart, a pie chart, or line chart, or any type of graphical representation of your statistical information, on that time you should know what is the use of Excel file, how to use this Excel file. So these three things of Microsoft Office Word, PowerPoint, Excel, these three things basically help you a lot during your graduation time, and even when you will be in your job field, on that time, it will help you a lot. Okay. So these are the things we are going to learn under this course CSE 104. Okay, and here you will get the book name. So fundamental theory and fundamental lab. Okay, for these two topics we have same book. Okay, first part, in the first part you are going to get the theory part, and the second part you are going to get lab part. Okay, that is the thing. If possible, I'm going to share the soft copy of this lab book with you. Okay, then here you can see the consultation hour. You know what is consultation hour. Basically, if you have any problem regarding any topic, if you need more clarification, then you can call me this time and these days. Okay, then as you are from section B, this is your class routine. Wednesday, 2:15 p.m. to 4:15 p.m. We have 2 hours consecutive class, lab class. Then mark evaluation. So this is very important. How I am going to evaluate your performance? Okay. At the end of your semester, all of our main goal to secure a very good CGPA. So if you want to secure a very good CGPA, on that time you have to understand this mark distribution. How I am going to evaluate you? So on your assignment and Viva. Okay, I'm going to take some Viva as well as I'm going to give some assignment to you. So for this work, I'm going to count 10% mark out of 100, 10 marks. Attendance in your lab class, attendance is very important, because in theory class, we have 5% mark on attendance, but lab class, we have 20% mark. You can see here. Excuse me. 20% mark in your attendance. So if you miss one class, one lab class, then you are going to lose a very good amount of marks. So this is my strong recommendation to you. Please do not miss any lab class. Then lab project and lab report. At the end of the semester, you have to submit a lab report. Inside the lab report, you have to submit maybe a 14 to 15 experiment. Okay, so that lab report, you have 25% mark. And then final examination, you have 45% mark. That means rest of the 45% mark in your final examination. In lab class, there is no first term examination, there is no midterm examination. Directly, you are going to sit for the final examination. Okay, so in total, 100% mark. Okay, then some general rules and regulations I basically mentioned here, if you remember. And the rules and regulations like that, first of all, you have to understand what are the academic offenses. Okay, that means if you perform this task, okay, then university will consider this thing as academic offense. You are not allowed to do this type of thing, like plagiarism. Plagiarism means you are basically using someone's property without giving him or her credit. Suppose I am giving you an assignment, you are not doing that assignment with your own, you are taking help from others, or you are just copying that assignment from somewhere else. So that is called actually plagiarism. Okay, you are basically copying from others. Then cheating in the examination, aiding or abetting. Okay, that means if you give any false information, if you cheat in the examination, this type of activity university will consider as academic offense. And if university find out guilty, okay, if university find out guilty that you basically perform this task, then university, they might take any action against you. Like in previous semester, we basically find out some cases like this. Some student basically did this type of activity, like cheating in the examination. So university basically give them F F for all the subject in that semester. Or university might suspend you for one semester or two semester. Even university might dismiss you from the university even. Okay, right. Okay, so abetting means basically you are basically helping others during the examination. Suppose I am taking an examination, as it is online examination, what you can do? You can help others. Okay, that is the thing. You can give support to others. But this is not ethical. This is not allowed. Okay, so if you find out committed this type of crime, then university will consider these activities as academic offense. then assignment prepared by others, impersonation of another student at an examination. That means instead of you, someone giving your examination, okay? Or instead of someone, you are giving his or her examination. This is called impersonation, okay? Then misrepresentation of information, if you give any false information, okay? Falsification of academic record, okay? Unruly behavior with instructor or your other classmate, okay? These type of things university consider as academic offense, and committing an academic offense may result in F grade or dismissal from the university. So you have to be careful about this thing. Then some other general policy like dress and behavior code, DBC, dress and behavior code is the full form. Dress code means you have to basically, those who are the boys, you have to wear formal dress, okay, like me. Basically, I'm basically wearing formal shirt, okay, with my ID card. Here is my ID card, you can see, and you have to wear tie. And always you have to unfold your sleeves, okay? And in the summer season, you can also wear a polo t-shirt, but round neck t-shirt is not allowed, okay? Round neck t-shirt is not allowed to wear during the university time, okay? And for girls, you can wear any sober dress according to the IBAT dress and code policy. Language code during the class time, okay, or for any other interaction with the course instructor or among your classmates, what you have to do, you have to always speak in English, okay? That's why they're mentioning English. Then some examination rules given here, like if you miss the examination date, directly your grade will be F. You will not get chance to sit for the late examination, okay? But if you have some, unavoidable circumstances, like if you are very sick, if you are hospitalized, or if your close relatives, if they are hospitalized somehow, unfortunately, then according to your previous performance, university will give you chance to sit for the late examination. Okay. And close relative means your father, mother, brother, and sister. Okay. Right. Then class participant, do not late in the class. Okay, you have to be punctual and you have to be regular. Okay, if you come late in the examination, if you come late in the class, then you will not be able to understand rest of the lecture, okay, what I am giving to you. Okay, if you miss a single class, maybe it will be tough to understand in your next class what I am going to say. That's why you don't miss any class, you have to be punctual. Then, class participation. During the class time, if you have any problem, please raise your question. Okay. If I ask any question to you, please try to respond if you know the answer. Do not gossiping, do not sleeping, do not make noise. Okay. Be patient and be helpful to each other. Okay. All right. So some other instruction given here regarding your assignment, like if you submit your assignment after the submission date, I'm going to give you penalty. You're going to lose you some mark. Okay. So don't be late to submit your assignment. Then lecture plan. I already uploaded the soft copy of this course outline in our Google Classroom. Okay. You can go there and you can download the thing. Okay. Download the course outline, and there you will get day-wise breakdown in which class, which topic we're going to cover. All right. Then this thing we already mentioned, consultation hour, contact information, we already discussed. Some summaries are given here, like maintain proper dress code. It basically make you more serious about your study. Okay, during the class time, if you laying on the bed, okay, if you do not maintain the proper dress code, if you eating and doing your online class, then you will not get that much seriousness. Okay. Be regular and punctual, right? You have to be regular. That means every day you have to come in the class and on time. Okay. Then bring your book. That means you have to have your course material with you when you attend the virtual class. Okay. You should keep a notebook. You should keep a pen with you so that you can take some notes. Then always speak in English. There is no alternative. Okay. You have to speak in English. And switch off your mobile phone. Okay, if you using your laptop or desktop, try to switch off your mobile phone or silent your mobile phone. Okay, so that it cannot distracted you. Then sit properly, okay? Then take your preparation for the next class. I told you that before join my class, please go through the previous lecture and please go through the lesson plan, okay, for my next class, so that you can understand what I am going to deliver in my next class, okay? In the lesson plan, inside the lesson plan, you will get time-wise breakdown, okay? Like first 5 minutes, what we are going to do, next 50 minutes, what we are going to do, next 5 minutes, what last 5 minutes, what we are going to do, okay? That is the thing. So that's all about your course outline. So do you have any question regarding this course outline, anyone?
What is
any question, anyone? I think no. So on the basis of your request, I basically discussed this course outline very briefly. Okay.
Sir, now, if we have a set B exam or set C exam, if anyone sick.
If you sick, you have to know me. You have to notify me earlier. Okay. You have to notify me earlier. Okay. And I am going to allow you in the examination if I find out that, okay, this student is regular. This student, his or her performance is good in his or her submitted assignment, okay, or quiz test. Okay. Different parameter, yes, sir, I am going to evaluate. Then I am going to allow you to sit for the examination. Okay.
That is okay, sir. Okay.
So it will be very hassle for you. So this is my strong recommendation. Not miss the examination if there is no unavoidable circumstances. All right?
Obviously.
Okay. So let's start our today's discussion. Okay. I'm going to share you another slide with you. Let me know whether you can see the slide or not. I think now this slide is visible to you, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
All right. Just a minute. Okay, all right. So now you can see the title of this chapter. According to your lab book, okay? Lab book, this one is chapter number 1, and the title of the chapter is what? Web browser. Okay, so in this slide, in this chapter, I'm going to discuss about some basic functionality of your computer. That means how basically your computer basically works. Then I'm going to discuss about some hardware inside the computer system. What are the hardwares you're going to get? Okay, and then I'm going to discuss about this web browser. Okay, what is web browser? Some example of web browser. Then we are going to discuss about the basic user interface of the web browser and how to use web browser. Okay, all right. So let's start our today's discussion. As I already mentioned, these are the lecture content you can see here. Okay, so the first topic I'm going to discuss, that is functional unit of your computer. Okay, functional unit of your computer. So here you can see mainly we have three parts. First of all, we have some input and output device. Then we have memory space, and then we have our, what is this? CPU, central processing unit, or microprocessor. Inside the computer system, mainly we have these three parts. This is the first one. This is the second one. And this is the third one. Okay. Now we are going to learn how basically these three things work simultaneously, work together. We know computer is a system, and inside the system we have number of components, and they are working together to achieve a common goal. So what is the goal of computer? The main goal of computer is to process something, to do some calculation. Okay. So if you follow this arrow symbol, by using our input devices, what we can do? We can give some input to our computer. We can give some instruction to our computer. Okay. Like as a user, I'm writing it down. Okay. As a user, we can give instruction to our computer by using different input devices. Okay, so can anyone mention some input device name? Can any of you mention input device name?
Keyboard, mouse.
Okay, scanner. These are the input device. Okay, right. So by using this device, we can give input to our computer. Then those inputted data, we can store permanently for this hard disk, or we can store temporarily for this RAM. Okay, we can store permanently for in this hard disk, or we can temporarily store inside the RAM. Okay, so RAM is called primary memory and hard disk is called secondary memory. RAM is called volatile memory and hard disk is called non-volatile memory. Okay, in our second chapter in the theory course, we are going to discuss about this RAM and hard disk more elaborate way. Okay, I'm going to give more explanation on those topic on those lecture. Okay, but for now, just remember RAM is called primary memory, hard disk is called secondary memory. RAM is called volatile memory and hard disk is called non-volatile memory. Okay, why RAM is called volatile memory? Okay, because if you shut down your computer, if you switch off your computer, then whatever the data we have, information we have inside the RAM, everything will be gone. Okay, but inside the hard disk, if you save any data or information inside the hard disk, then if you reboot your computer, then again you will get those information inside the hard disk. That's why RAM is called volatile memory and hard disk is called non-volatile memory. Whenever you are giving any data to your computer, at first you have to save it either inside the hard disk or inside the RAM. Okay, then from your hard disk or RAM, your processor will be able to access those data or information to perform a specific operation. Like inside the processor, we have two part. One is arithmetic and logical unit. This is the arithmetic and logical unit. And we have another part that is called control unit. Okay, control unit. So whatever the logical work, whatever the mathematical equation, calculation, everything basically done by your logical and arithmetical and logical unit. Okay. On the other hand, this control unit basically control different hardwares, different softwares. Okay, it basically control everything. Inside the computer system, we have number of components. So this control system responsible to control those hardware or control those software. Okay, and after processing data, follow the arrow symbol, your processor will give the will give the output. And by using the output devices, as a user, we can visualize the thing. Okay, again, from by using the output device, user can visualize, okay, or see the output. Okay, can anyone mention some output device name? What is the output monitor, device you have?
Yes.
Monitor,
printer,
soundbox,
speaker,
soundbox. Okay.
Right. Okay. So these are actually what? Nothing but your output devices. All right.
Sir, it's Samin.
Please.
Sir, what is the difference between data and information?
Okay. Data means actually raw fact. And information means processed data. Data means raw fact. And information means process data. Data will not give you any meaning to you. Okay, data
will not
give you any meaning to you. But information will give you some meaning to you. Okay, for an example, suppose when you purchase any product from the super shop. Okay, any super shop, when you purchase any product, on that time you will get a barcode on the product, isn't it? Do you know what is barcode?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the barcode here?
Yes, sir.
I'm showing my what is
marker,
this?
Barcode.
Marker. Okay, in front of you. And here you can see the barcode. If I am not wrong. Okay? This is the
barcode. Sir.
And if I give you this barcode to you, and if I tell you that, what do you understand by reading this barcode? Can anyone tell
Nothing.
Me what do you understand by reading this barcode?
Nothing, sir.
Nothing, isn't
Nothing,
it?
Sir.
But if I scan this barcode by using a barcode scanner, okay? If I scan this barcode by using a barcode scanner, then your computer After processing this barcode, your computer can tell you what is the product name, what is the product color, what is the product price, who is the manufacturer, and other details, isn't it? So
yes, sir.
To
yes,
our computer, I am giving this data, and our computer giving us information about this product after processing data. You understand? That's why I am
yes,
telling
sir.
Data
yes,
is an object. It will not give you any meaning to you. On the other hand, after processing data, we get information. All right?
Thank you, yes, sir.
Okay, another example I can give you. Suppose in our class, now we have in total 22 participants. Okay? So if I collect all of your data, like if I collect all of your age, if I collect all of your age, okay? After collecting all of your age, I can manipulate this data. I can analyze this data. And what information I might get after analyzing this data? Can anyone tell me what type of information I might get? I might get who is the youngest one, isn't it, in this class? Who is the
yes, sir.
Oldest one?
Oldest one. It?
What is the average
sir,
age of
average.
This class? Right?
Yes, sir. Okay. Average.
So
yes,
these are the information we might get. Okay. So now you understand what is data and what is information. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So never say that. Sometimes what happens, if I ask you that what is information, you guys say that sir, data is information. And when I ask you that what is data, you say that information is data. Okay. But there is a significant difference in between data and information. Data and information is not same thing. Okay. Remember.
Okay, sir.
All right. So do you have any problem to understand this function, computer
no,
function?
No, sir. Okay.
So I'm giving a small example here. Suppose I'm giving two input here. Okay. Two. Okay. And two. Okay. These two numeric value I'm giving by using my keyboard. I'm giving these two information, to, giving these two data to my computer. Okay. And suppose now these data are inside this data inside this RAM. Okay. And I would like to perform multiplication operation in between these two. Okay. Then which part responsible to do this thing? My
arithmetic and logic.
Arithmetic and logic. Right. So it will do multiplication. 2 multiplied by 2. Okay. This task done by this arithmetic and logical operation. And this control unit give me the memory space or other hardwares it will give me to perform this operation. Okay. After performing this operation, I will be able to show the
output
to my computer monitor. And the output will be 2 plus 2, 4. Isn't it? And yes, by yes, using this output device, I can see, as a user, I can see my output. Okay, that is the thing. I think now you have some idea how this basically computer work.
Yes, sir.
But we have many things more. Okay. This is a very vast thing. Okay. So in your different courses, you are going to learn about different things about this functionality of your computer. Okay. But this is the basic concept. This is the basic concept. We have mainly three parts. Input output device, or in short we can call it IO. IO means input output device. Sometimes we call it peripherals. Peripheral means all kind of input output device. Then we have memory space, then we have microprocessor or CPU. Am I right to you? Am I clear to you?
Yes, sir.
So you have yes, to sir. Understand one another thing as a computer science student, as a user, can you see, as a user directly we cannot give input to our microprocessor. As a user directly, suppose if I want to directly give input like this, okay, it is not allowed, it is not possible. Okay, I have to follow this
okay. rule.
I have to give instruction to my microprocessor through my memory space. Through my memory space, okay. So, in other courses, you're going to learn about hard disk, RAM, or even you're going to learn about the cache memory, okay, you are going to learn about the transistor, okay. Transistor, this is the very smallest memory unit. Okay, that is the thing. Okay.
Sir, hello, sir. Here, Alamin Akashit is speaking.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
What is the difference between RAM and ROM?
Okay, basically, RAM is RAM, you know, random memory, access.
Yeah, random access memory.
And ROM means read-only memory. ROM means read-only memory. Okay. RAM, basically, we can call it this actually what? Volatile memory. Okay. And ROM, R-O-M, ROM, read-only memory. This one is fixed. This one is permanent. Okay, this one is permanent. You cannot change this. Read only memory. You cannot write.
Non-volatile.
That is the thing. And sometimes we have different types of ROM. We have different types of ROM. Okay, like think about your pen drive. What is this? RAM and ROM. RAM or ROM? Pen drive?
ROM.
ROM.
ROM. That is actually ROM, isn't it? Okay. Now you might tell me that, sir, you mentioned the name read only memory. We can read it, read that memory only. We cannot insert any data or we cannot update it. But pen drive we can update, isn't it? Okay. We can delete some data. We can insert some data, isn't it? So what is the confusion here? That like there are different types of ROM. Okay. There are different types of ROM. Like pen drive is called electrically, erasable read-only memory. Okay, electrically erasable read-only memory. Okay, ROM.
Okay,
so that's why we can erase that thing. We have number of ROM, maybe 7 or 8 types of ROM we have, maybe more than that. Okay, that is the thing. So in our hardware theory class, we're going to discuss about detail about this RAM and ROM. Okay, not here. But I'm giving you a very, basic idea. RAM means read-only, random access memory, and ROM means read-only memory. RAM is volatile, ROM is non-volatile. Okay. Volatile means after starting your computer, restarting your computer, all the data will be gone from the RAM. But ROM, you will get back to your data even after restart your computer. Am I clear to you? Is it okay, Alamin?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I have a question.
Please.
What is different between hard disk and SSD?
Okay, there are different types of hard disk. There are different types of hard disk nowadays we have. Okay, so SSD is one version. Okay, nowadays basically we are using this SSD, but SSD still, the price of SSD is a little bit high. Okay, but the working procedure, speed is very fast in SSD hard disk. It is basically one classification of the hard disk. Okay. So again, in your hardware course, you are going to learn about mechanism, how basically it basically works, okay, and other things regarding the SSD. But SSD basically one kind of your hard disk. Okay.
Okay, sir.
All right. Okay, so I think we can move to the next portion. Okay. So here we can see some basic computer components, basic computer hardware, like we have a speaker. Okay. What type of device this one is? Input device or output device? Speaker?
Output.
Output device. Then microphone. Here we can see the picture of microphone. This is input.
Or also output.
Input.
Microphone is output.
The input device.
Microphone is input device.
Sir, input device.
Microphone, we can give input output device.
Comments.
To our computer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Here we have keyboard, here we have mouse. So what type of device they are?
Input.
Input.
Device. Very good. Okay. Then monitor, what type of device this one is?
Output device.
All right. And here you can see the system unit. And we can define, we can call it this system unit by using different name. Can you please mention some other name of this system unit?
Monitor.
Computer case.
Computer casing, computer chassis. Okay, different name we have.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Okay. Then move to the next point. So this is the outside of the computer casing, isn't it? Outside of the computer casing, we have monitor, speaker, microphone, mouse.
Please mute everyone's.
Please mute everyone. If you need not to talk, then please mute. Then this is the system unit, and let's see what we have inside the system unit. Okay, our computer casing. So this is the picture you can see here, isn't it? This is the picture you can see. Okay. So here you can see power supply unit. Okay, inside the computer casing, the first one given here, the power supply unit. Follow my mouse pointer. Huh? Power supply unit. Okay. Can anyone tell me what is the use of this power supply unit?
To power up the whole CPU, I think, sir.
That means it provides power to our computer.
Like yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
But this concept is totally wrong. Okay. power supply unit basically not provide power to your computer through your power cord, through your power cord. In our previous theory class, we basically learned about the power cord, isn't it? If you remember.
Okay, yes, sir.
Power cord. Okay. Right. And I also show you the power cord as well. So through this power cord, we can supply electricity from the wall socket to our computer. But this power supply unit basically play role as converter. Play role as power or energy
converter.
Converter. Inside the computer, inside this computer casing, you will get number of hardware, and in some cases, some hardware need basically only 5 volt power supply. Some hardware need suppose 10 volt power supply. Some hardware suppose need 15 volt power supply. But from the wall socket, how much power supply you are getting from the wall socket?
220 volts, sir.
220 to 240 volt. In Bangladesh, we are getting 220 to 240.
240.
So I mean, a hardware need only 5 volts, but if I supply that 220 volt, then what happened?
It will burst out. It
crashed, sir.
It might burn, yes, that. It might burn that. Not might. It will burn that hardware, isn't it? Okay. So that's where,
yes, sir,
need,
yes,
power,
sir,
supply unit. And this power supply unit basically controls the supply of power.
Supplies the power. Yes.
Okay.
Sir.
Which hardware sir, need what amount of power? It basically supply specific amount of power to that hardware. Okay, that's why we can say that it's a converter, it's a kind of converter, we can say. All right.
Okay, sir.
Then
yes, sir. It's a kind of transformer.
You can say. Okay, right. So CPU and cooling fan. Okay. So here we cannot see the CPU. Can you see the CPU here?
No, sir. CPU is under the cooling
fan. Under the cooling fan, right? Okay. But what is the use of this cooling fan?
So that during
when you operate the computer, it basically give you some air. Is this the use of cooling fan?
No, sir. It basically then cools up
for,
the
for cooling,
processor. Right. It basically help you to cooling your micro
system.
CPU. Yes, sir. Okay. So yes, what happened?
Get heated.
Right. So if you run your computer, you see after 5 minutes, okay, that CPU become very hot. Okay, very warm. Okay. So if any, I mean, device or any machine become very hot, okay, or warm, then it will not be able to perform its task in a proper manner. So we have to,
yes, sir,
arrange some cooling system for that. Okay, we have to arrange some cooling system for that. So here, this what is this? This cooling fan playing role as cooler. Okay, that is the thing. Yeah, basically, sure, cooling up that microprocessor. Okay, so but here you can see only the cooling fan. But I would like to show you what we have basically here. Okay, I am going to share my video from my another account, and please let me know whether you can see the video or not from my another account. Okay, give me a moment. Just a minute. I'm going to stop my sharing so that you can see it. Okay, so I think now you can see the video from my another account. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Make me clean. Okay, all right. So I pinned the video. So here you can see my laptop. Okay. So now I would like to show you the thing we have under this cooling fan. Okay. All right. Okay. Can you see the CP the casing?
Yes, sir. We
yes,
can
sir.
See.
Okay. All right. So this is our cooling fan. This is the position of my cooling fan.
Cooling fan.
Inside the inside my computer casing, I have number of hardwares. You can see, okay. And here is my cooling fan. Okay, if you follow my finger. Okay, this is my cooling fan. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And here you will get some lock. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Four locks. By using these four locks, what we can do? We can attach this cooling fan with my motherboard. Okay, this is the motherboard. You can see. Okay. Huge circuit, a big circuit you can see here. This is called nothing but my motherboard. Okay.
And under the cooling fan.
Cooling fan. We can attach this cooling fan by using this lock. Okay. Four locks I have. So if I unlock it, then I can able to separate it from my motherboard. So, and you can see one by using one wire, it basically connected with this motherboard. Can you see that? Okay, this is the wire. Okay, I am holding the cooling fan, and this through this wire, this cooling fan connected with this motherboard. Okay, this is the plug you can see. Okay, so if I unplug it, give me a moment. Now I can make it totally separate from my motherboard. Okay, that is the thing. So this is your cooling fan. Can you guys see the cooling fan?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
And this is the power cable. Okay. And this one is basically attached with the motherboard. I have to attach this power cord with the motherboard so that it gets some electricity supply. Okay. And this cooling fan basically manufactured by Intel. You can see here.
Yes, sir.
This is the manufactured by Intel. Okay. And under this cooling fan, here you will get another thing that is called. Can you tell me what is this called?
It is an aluminium sink.
Okay, this is actually called heat sink. Okay, it can absorb the heat. We have cooling fan.
Yes, sir.
Under this cooling fan, we have heat sink. Okay, this is called heat sink. Okay, right. Then under this heat sink, what we have? We have our
the processor.
This is the brain of our computer. Okay. And this is called basically CPU socket. CPU socket. This thing is called basically what?
Socket.
CPU socket. We can place our CPU inside it. So here is a lock. Okay. I can make it unlock. Okay. So I am making it unlock. And now if I try to open it, it will open. Okay. Okay. Now this lock is open. And now I can pull out this CPU. Okay. And this is my CPU. You can see here, okay, and this is the socket. This is particularly what? CPU socket. Okay, so we have CPU socket. We can place this microprocessor on this CPU socket. Okay, over that we have heat sink, over that we have cooling fan. Okay, so now here you can see the microprocessor, and we can call it the brain of the computer. Okay. And here you can see on a silicon plate, we have, number of transistor. Okay, number of transistor over there. Okay, you can see here. Okay, and this is the, another side of this microprocessor. And this one is also manufactured by actually Intel.
Intel.
It's written here, written over there. Okay, Intel. All right. And this one is Intel Pentium microprocessor. Okay. And it's written here, it's actually 3.86 gigahertz. Okay, so many information given here, that means processing speed given here. Okay, and another thing we have on this CPU. Okay, can you see some dust over there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, but these are not actually dust. Okay, these are basically what? Thermal gel. These are not dust, these are basically what? Thermal gel. Okay, we are not only using heat sink, cooling fan, we are also using thermal gel. This thermal gel basically help to make this device more cooler.
Pass the heat.
Can you see that? Thermal gel, okay, over it.
Yes, sir.
So, as well as here in this side, okay, you can also see the thermal gel. Okay, somehow this one is become dry, okay. It basically your thermal gel. Correct. If I move my hand over there, then you can see some dust on my finger, isn't it? Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is nothing but your thermal gel.
Sir, I have a question.
Please. What is your question?
If I don't use the thermal gel, will there be any problem?
It will not create that much problem if you have a good cooling fan. Okay, in the market you will get different types of cooling fan. Okay, and it basically vary quality to quality. So if you use a very good quality cooling fan, there is no problem. Okay, but is better to use thermal gel. In the market you can purchase separately this thermal gel.
Okay, sir.
There is a proverb, you know that, isn't it? Joto good toto mitha, isn't it? Okay, so thing is same. Okay, am I right about this CPU, about this cooling fan, about this heat sink, about the CPU socket?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Here you can see this box. This box.
Power supply.
Power supply unit. Okay, and you can see a bunch of wire. Okay, coming out from this, what?
Power supply box
unit. Okay, and all the hardwares, okay, directly or partially connected with this power supply unit. Am I clear to you?
Yes,
all the hardwares, what you have inside this computer, okay, all of them are directly or partially connected with this power supply unit. Okay. And here you can see number of information, okay, given over there. Okay, that is it.
Yes, sir. Model.
Model and other things also given here. Okay, that means you can see here. If I show it more closely, can you see how much input it take?
Yes, sir.
Okay, 320 volt. Okay. And if I convert it, then it is 50 hertz. Okay, that is the thing. And output, you see, 12 volt, isn't it? 5 volt.
Yes, sir.
3.3 volt minus 12 volt. Plus 5 VSB. Maybe what I don't know what is the standard given here. Okay, volt. Okay, so you see your computer device, they need basically different. Different amount of volt. Okay. So it will take input from the wall socket 220, okay, or 320, and it can convert that power supply into this. Okay, that is the thing. Right. All right. All right.
Sir, I have a question.
Please.
Sir, I've heard that in the processor there is a layer of gold. Is it true, sir?
Yes.
Okay, let me show my video again. Okay, so can you see the layer? In the microprocessor. This is the microprocessor. Okay, here we have the gold. Okay, that is it. Why basically we are using gold instead of copper? In some hardware we are using gold instead of copper. Okay, copper is a good conductor, but gold is better than the copper. Okay, that's why. In some device, we are using basically what is gold as conductor,
gold.
So that it can pass the signal in a faster rate. And our CPU need to use what need to send or receive the signal in a very faster manner. Okay, that's why basically those are the manufacturer they basically use gold over there. Okay, that is the thing. But if you think that if I sell this microprocessor to any gold shop, then they are not going to purchase this one, okay? Because with this gold, they basically mix up some other materials, okay? That's why you are not going to get a pure gold here, okay? But definitely there is a layer of gold, okay? That is it.
So many companies purchasing so many type of you,
right?
And okay. They are and they can output gold.
Right. I saw one YouTube video. Okay, I saw over there that they are basically collecting number of computer device. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And then they are basically trying to separate gold from those hardwares. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But they are using number of chemicals. Yeah, time to talk.
All right. Okay. Here is a gold, but this is not pure. You have to basically make it pure to sell it. Okay. That is it. All right. So, any other question do you have? Okay. All right. So, let me share my slide again. Okay. Okay, so again, come back to our slide. So we discuss about power supply, we discuss about CPU, okay, and cooling fan and other things. Then we have DIMM. This is basically, nowadays we are using different types of RAM. This is basically indicating RAM, okay. And here the picture is, though the picture is very hazy and small, this is basically RAM slot. And here we have a RAM. Okay. Do you guys see the RAM? Do you guys want to see the RAM? If you want, then I can show it to you. Again, I am sharing my video with you so that you can visualize the RAM. Okay. So can you again see my video?
Yes, sir.
All right. So here we have. So here we have a RAM slot. Can you see the slot? Blue slot we have here.
Yes, sir.
Two blue slots side by side. Okay. Two blue yes, slots sir. Side by side. This is basically nothing but your RAM slot. And I have one RAM here. And in this slide we have two clip. So we can make it open by pressing it.
I think sir, there are four slots.
You can see here four slot, right? So this is my RAM.
Yes, sir.
All right. This is actually what? The picture of
Hello.
RAM. And this is actually DDR3. Nowadays we are using DDR3. Okay. That is DDR3. And some other information you can also find out.
Yeah. So what does it mean DDR3?
I forget the full meaning. Okay. So in your hardware course, you are basically going to learn about this thing. So Google it as well. DDR3, and this is the latest version. Okay, and you can see that this is actually what the RAM size also given here. This is a 4GB RAM. This is a 4GB RAM. It's written over here. Okay, can you see that? 4GB.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. We have 2GB RAM. Okay, you can also connect a 4GB RAM. Okay, some other slot we have. If I add, I can add another 4GB RAM. Okay, this is the RAM. Okay, physical RAM you can see here. Okay, and what is this called? This is actually what? Volatile or non-volatile?
Volatile.
This is volatile. Okay. It easily forgot. Okay. That means if you switch off your computer, automatically whatever the data we have inside the RAM, everything will be gone. Is it okay? RAM. And here you can see the RAM slot. Okay. Again, I'm showing number of RAM slot I have. Okay. That is the thing. And then here you can see the motherboard. My motherboard basically manufactured by Gigabyte. Can you see that Gigabyte? Okay, Gigabyte.
Yes, sir.
So this is basically developed by the Gigabyte. Some other things also we have, like here you can see the expansion slot. Okay, these are the expansion slot we have. Okay, these are called expansion slot. Okay. So if you want, you can add your TV card, sound card, graphics card, okay, this type of thing you can add here. Then we have one CMOS battery. Can you see the CMOS battery here?
Yes, sir.
Let me show you. This is the CMOS battery. Okay, this is called CMOS battery. So I can pull it out. Pull it out. There is a clip. By using one hand, it is tough to pull out. Here we have one clip. Okay, by pressing this clip, we can make it out. Okay, so this is the CMOS battery, a small battery we have. Okay, that is the thing. Okay, and if somehow this battery become out of order, okay, then you will not get update date and time in your computer. Okay, automatically your computer will show back date, back time, I mean wrong time. Okay, that is the thing. So on that time you have to change your CMOS battery. Okay, so we have some other use of this CMOS battery in the hardware course. Again, you're going to learn about the CMOS battery. Then we have number of device, number of wires you can see here. Okay, number of connectors you can see here. Okay, then what else we have? Okay, what is this called? Can anyone tell me? Okay, this rack shape, what is this called?
These are the slots for hard disk and DVD ROM, I think.
Okay, and what is the name? What is the name of this
thing?
No, drive bay. Okay, drive bay. If you remember, drive bay. Okay, that is the thing. And here I have my in this point. Okay, here I have my. You can see from here. This is actually what my DVD ROM. This is the DVD ROM.
Yeah.
So if I want to insert any DVD disc, I can use this DVD ROM. So here you can see my hard disk. This is the hard disk. Okay. I cannot pull it out as because this is basically attached with this two screw. Okay, but here is my hard disk. Okay, can you see that hard disk?
Yes, sir.
So this is my hard disk. Okay, and this is non-volatile memory. Inside this hard disk, we have number of magnetic plate. Magnetic plate we have inside the hard disk. Okay, and here we have a number of other, I mean, connector. Or you can say number of other. Can you see that? Okay, these are the actually what
connectors.
Here you can connect your your Ethernet port,
monitor
port, USB port. Then we have some other port like audio in, audio out, SATA port, PATA port. Okay, like that. Okay, these are the port we have. Okay, basically if I show it from the outside, then you can easily understand. Okay, this is the real picture you can see here. We have PS2 port, we have SATA port, we have PATA port, we have VCA port, HDMI port, we have like.
So where is the HDMI port?
Hmm?
Where is the HDMI port, sir?
Do I have HDMI port here? I'm not seeing any HDMI port here, but in my laptop I can show it to you. Okay. Okay, the laptop. Can you see this port?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Clearly, sir.
This is nothing but your HDMI port. Okay, the port here we have. Okay. Okay. This port.
Yes, sir.
Okay. This port is the HDMI port. And we use basically this HDMI port to connect with our projector. Okay, projector, which basically need to connect with this HDMI port. All right. Okay, so let me go back to my slide again. Okay, all right. So I already show you this RAM. Okay, then CD drive. My CD drive I already show it to you. Then there are some other slot I already mentioned. Then we have internal bay. This is called drive bay. Okay. Then you will get number of other port. Okay, that like for hard disk. Okay, this is the hard disk. Show here. They're showing here some expansion slot. Okay, here you can add TV card or your sound card or graphics card. Number of card you can add here. So this is the internal view of your computer casing. Okay, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I think so far it's okay. In our hardware class, again we are going to discuss about some other things from this computer casing. We are going to learn about,
yes, sir,
what we have in the front side of the computer case. Sorry.
Sir, I can see there is a little thing named card reader, sir. What is the card reader in this box?
Okay, basically it depends model to model. There are different models we have for this computer casing. In some computer casing, we have this facility that you can use card reader. Card reader means you can insert your micro SD card, okay, which basically we use with your mobile phone. Okay, we use SSD card, okay, micro card. Okay, then we also use card memory card with our DSLR camera. Okay, so you can also directly insert those card in the card slot. There are some card slot also available over there. Okay, that is the thing. Okay, so you can insert those card and you can play, you can use those port as a card reader. Okay, that is the okay. So the next one, they're basically mentioning here different types of computer. Okay, we already have idea about different types of computer. Basically, we already discussed about different types of computer in our first chapter: laptop computer, desktop computer, server computer, and tablet computer. Then now I'm going to discuss about what is web browser. Can anyone tell me what is web browser? Anyone?
Sorry, it's basically a software by which we can surf the internet.
Right.
And we can download from it, we can upload something to the internet, and we can communicate with through this.
All right. So web browser is nothing but an application, okay, or a software. Okay. So by using this web browser, what we can do, we can retrieve, we can present, we can transferring information resources on the worldwide web. Okay, that means we can search any information in the worldwide web. Okay, we can present any information, we can insert any information, okay, in the worldwide web. Okay, suppose you'd like to access your Facebook page, you'd like to browse Google, you'd like to browse YouTube. On that time, you need this software. Without this software, you are not able to connect your computer with your internet. Okay, so this is the web browser, and you can see some popular web browser. Okay, their logo and their name. First one is Mozilla Firefox, second one is Google Chrome, third one is Microsoft Explorer. Though nowadays, basically, they introduce the updated version of Microsoft Explorer. Okay, and that one is good. Okay, then Apple Safari. Okay, and the Opera Mini. Okay, so some of them are desktop based, some of them are mobile based. Like Opera Mini, this is mobile based operating system. Okay, as well as Google Chrome, we also find out this one in our desktop or laptop computer, as well as in our mobile phone as well.
Mobile.
Okay,
Mozilla Firefox.
Okay, then who developed this web browser? This is very important invention. Okay, in the field of computer science. So we have to know who is the developer, when and why he developed this software. So Tim Berners-Lee is the developer or inventor of this software that is called web browser. He developed this one in the year of 1990, and they basically released the web browser, the first version of web browser, in the year of 1991. Okay, so remember the name Tim Berners-Lee, and developed in 1990. Right. So an interviewer asked him a question, that is, why did you invent this WWW? He is also called the inventor of this worldwide web. Okay, previously all the computers were not connected with each other. Okay, do not have this facility that they can share the resources from one computer to another computer. Okay, but after developing this web browser, we can connect one computer with another computer. Okay, we can download, we can share our files. Okay, that's why the interviewer asked him this question: why did you invent this WWW, World Wide Web? So can anyone read his answer?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Well, I found it frustrating that in those days there was different information on different computers, but you had to log on to different computers to get it or get at it. Also, some learn program on each computer, said Tim Berners-Lee.
All right. So, Kanvir, can you explain what you understand from this small paragraph?
Yes, sir. Tim Berners-Lee found that the if he needed some information from another computer, he need to access that computer, and sometimes he need to know the program to run that computer. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit frustrating to him, so he invented a program which is the web browser. Through that he can connect to any computers to his computer.
Right.
Through his computer, actually.
Right. So ultimately what happens, suppose before invention of this World Wide Web, okay, so if Tanvir wants a document to me, what I have to do? Tanvir need to come to me, and by using his pen drive, he can copy that document and he can insert that document to his computer. Okay. But now what we can do? Now, because of this World Wide Web, I can send it to his email address, isn't it? I can share that document through my Google Drive, through my Google Classroom, isn't it? Without WWW, World Wide Web, is it possible? It is not possible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this WWW, okay, World Wide Web, is basically make our life more easier, isn't it? Okay. Right.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the next point I would like to discuss, that is basic user interface of a web browser. So let me open my web browser and let me share it with you. I'd like to share my web browser with you. Okay, let me know whether you can see my web browser or not on your screen.
Yes, sir, I can see it. Mozilla Firefox.
Yes, sir.
Right. So we have different types of, web browser. But as example, I'm using basically Mozilla Firefox. So this Mozilla Firefox, this is basically one popular web browser nowadays we are using. So let me show you different part of this Mozilla Firefox. Just a minute. Okay. So the first part I would like to indicate, can just follow my mouse pointer, huh? So what is the name of this part? Can anyone tell me? I'm making it red. Okay.
Title bar.
Tab.
Yes,
this is called tab.
And title bar.
Right. This is called tab. Okay. So what you can do, you can create a new tab by clicking on this plus symbol. Okay. Or you can close this tab by using this cross symbol. Am I clear to you? If I click this plus, then it will create another tab. Okay. If I click on this cross, then it will close this tab. Is that clear?
Yes,
sir.
First part.
Yes, sir.
The second portion. Yes, please.
What does mean by tab?
Tab means, I don't know what is the Bengali meaning of tab. Basically, by using this tab, we can open different pages in different window. That is the thing. Okay. So this is one page. And I can open another page by clicking on another tab. Okay. This is another page. Okay. So suppose in this tab, I can open my Facebook. In this tab, I can open my YouTube. In this tab, I can open my Google. Okay. So in different tab, I can open different website or different web page I can open. Okay. this is the tab. Then next portion I would like to share with you, that is upper right corner. Okay, all right. Again, I'm marking it. So here we have three options, isn't it? Here we have options. First of all, we have this minus symbol. That means we can minimize. Okay. If I click, then it will be minimized. Okay. I think you cannot see the. Okay, I'm sharing it from the screen. Okay, now you guys can see my desktop. So again, I am marking that one. Yes. Okay. So if I click on this minus symbol, that means it will minimize the window. Okay. You see, it automatically minimize my window. And where I have that software? I have that software in my taskbar. Do you know which one is called taskbar? Can you see the red marking point?
Yes, sir.
This is called actually what? Nothing but task bar. Okay. This is called task bar. And here, whatever the, softwares are open. Okay. Now you can find out all the softwares. Or according to your need, we can pin the software in this task bar. Okay. So here is my Mozilla Firefox. Again, if I click on this, then again it will give me back my Mozilla Firefox software. Okay, so in this way you can minimize it, you can change the size of your software. I mean resize, you can make it resize. Okay, like this. Okay, right. Then you can make it maximize. If I click again here, it will maximize it. All right. Then we can close it by clicking on this cross symbol. We can close it. Is that okay with you?
Yes, sir.
All right. So far we discussed about this tab, okay, and this minimize, maximize, and close option. The next point I would like to discuss about this part. Okay, this is actually backward. This is actually forward arrow. If you want to go back, you can press on this backward arrow symbol. If you would like to go forward, you can click on this forward arrow. Okay. After that, here we have refresh symbol. If I click on this refresh symbol, it will reload my contents. Okay. Then I have the home page. If I home option, if I click on this home, it will take me the home page of this on this Mozilla Firefox. This is the important one. Next part. This is actually what? Search box.
Search bar.
Right. Search bar. Okay. Search bar. So what we can do here, we can type any URL. Okay. URL, like if I would like to go YouTube, I can write down YouTube here. Okay, automatically it's come. Okay. YouTube.com. If I would like to go Google, I have to write down Google.com. Okay. So these are the things we can write down here. That means any domain name, any URL, you can write down. In which website you would like to visit, you have to write down that website URL or website name here. Okay. Right. Address bar. Sometimes we can call it address bar as well. All right. Then let's see what we have. We have by default here we have a search bar. Okay, if you search something here, automatically it will search that information from the Google. Okay, if I search something here, automatically it will take me Google and it will search the information from the Google. Okay, then here we have a download symbol. If you want to see your download files, you can click here and it will show you the downloaded file. Okay. Then here you can see a library. Okay. Or you can bookmark your page. Okay. Bookmark means like if you find out a page is important to you, then you can mark that page for the future access, future use. Okay, if I click here, you can see here. Okay, from here we can find out the bookmark. Okay, if I click here, bookmark, then you can see, you can add the bookmark here. Then here are some other options also available, like history we have. In previous 7 days, in previous previous month, in which pages you basically visited, everything you find out from this history. Then download, you can find out your downloaded file from here as well. Okay, and some other information given here, which pages recently I visited, all the informations are given here. Okay, you can see. Okay, then from here I can make the, I can select the bookmark. So this is the bookmark option. Okay, right. Then here you can see your profile. If I am logging into this Mozilla Firefox, then it will show my picture and name and other information. Okay, I am not logged in this Mozilla Firefox. That's why it is not showing my picture and other information. Then here we have other options are available, and out of those, some functions are important. I'm just notifying those information functions. Like here we have new window. So if I click this one, new window, automatically it will create another window. Okay, another window it is going to create for me. Let me click this one. So now I have here, you can see, now I have two windows. Okay, two Mozilla Firefox window, isn't it? Okay, two windows I have. Okay, then like you can zoom in, you can zoom out. Zoom out means text will be small. If I zoom in, then it will show the text big font. All right. Then library option again we have. Okay, and what you can do, you can set your password. Okay. You can set your password. Sometimes what happens, most of the time we are not willing to sign out from our personal devices. Suppose if you are using Facebook in your own device, most of the cases we do not sign out or log out from that account. Okay, so what happens if someone gets access in our device, they can take admin access over me, isn't it, for that account. So for that, what I can do, I can set password. Okay, and when someone open my web browser, at first to browse something, he or she need to give the password, otherwise it will not work. Okay, some other option also available. You can print, you can save any page. Okay, you can open any file, and other things also available here. And if you want to exit, you can click over there. Okay, so these are the basic operations we have here. Here we have setting option. If you click here, it will open the setting option. Okay, you can change your interface, you can change your background color, you can change your theme, you can change the your language. Okay, many things you can do here. Okay, so this is the basic user interface of our web browser, but it basically vary web browser to web browser. If I open another web browser, you're not going to get same interface. You're not going to get the same interface. Okay, let me open another web browser. Okay, so the interface of this web browser is different. You can see here. Okay, interface of this web browser is different here. I am using now Microsoft Explorer. Okay, interface is not as look as like as your Mozilla Firefox. Again, if I open Google Chrome, you will get different interface. Okay, so but basic functionalities are same, but the basic functionalities are same. Okay, here is the address bar, here is the forward key, backward key, refresh button, tab. Okay, minimize, maximize, close. Okay, then settings information. Okay, basic things are same, but interface or the design might be different. Am I clear to you?
Yes, sir.
So this is the basic interface of your web browser. Okay, let me go back to my slide again. Okay, all right, so we already learned how to use the web browser. Okay, so that's all about this lecture.
Sir, I have a question.
Please, what is the question?
I need a suggestion. Mm-hmm. How can I bookmark I'm on Microsoft Explorer?
All right, let me check. Okay, I'm sharing my screen again. I'm sharing my web browser. It might take a few seconds to load on your screen. I think you can see now, isn't it?
Yes, sir. I can see that.
All right. So here you will get one star symbol, star plus symbol. Okay. So if you click here, then you will get the option for bookmark. Okay. Okay. Bookmark. Okay. Yes, so from here, you can select any bar, or you can select any specific page. Suppose this is the one I have here. Okay. Can you see the web address already written here?
I can see that.
The tab name already given here, isn't it? Okay. So here, from here, we can also, save our favorite address or favorite tab, okay? Or other things we can also perform here. Okay, that is the thing. You can also write down here URL. Okay. Let me show it to you. Also write down the URL, and if I save it, automatically it will be saved, okay, in my computer. Okay. Okay, and just a minute. Okay, and again, if you go back over there, you will get those URL saved in your computer. Okay, that is the thing. So from this star symbol, okay, you can mark any web page as bookmark. Okay, so I think if you explore it a little bit, you can find out mark for option. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
All right.
Sir, I can get it.
But in different web browser, you will get different options. Like if I go to my Mozilla Firefox, then you will get different symbol for that. Okay. Right. Okay. You will get different symbol for that. You can add it in the library. Okay. All right. I think now you have some idea. So as I already mentioned, that's all about my past lecture. You can see here, you will get some home task. Learn about the basic parts of computer. Please explore yourself. Okay. Then practice the basic use of computer. Okay. Then read the chapter 1 from the book. As you do not have the book, you need not to read it for now. Just go through this slide, okay? Install web browser in your computer. If you do not have the web browser in your computer, install it and explore much more. I mean, there are lots of information, options available inside the web browser. So in this short time, it is not possible to show all of them. I'm just showing the basic things. What you can do, you can explore yourself, okay? There are some Google search engine, you can search something in the Google. You have YouTube, okay? You can Google, you can search some tutorial over there, okay? Okay, and learn the basic user interface of the web browser, okay? So that's all about my lecture, okay? For this lecture number 1. Now let me know, do you have any question or not regarding this one? Any questions so far?
No, sir. Not right now.
Everything is all right.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Here, Alamin Akashis is speaking.
Mm-hmm.
On top of my PC, there are 2 audio jacks. One of them I broke down, so I didn't get the output from my computer. Sometimes I play a song, I didn't get any output from my computer. And there is also an audio jack behind my PC. It also doesn't work so that I can get any output from my computer speaker. How can I repair it?
Okay, so basically with our computer casing, we have 2 audio in, audio output. One is front side, another one is in back side. at first check whether both of them are not okay. Okay, if both of them are not okay, then definitely you have to replace it. If both of them are not okay, then you have to replace it. You can go to any repair shop, okay, servicing center. They are going to, I mean, replace that one. Okay, there you can, I mean, separately you can install audio in or audio out port. Separately you can install. Okay, or if you find out that front side one is not okay, you can use the back side. If back side is not okay, then you can also try with the front side. Okay, that is the thing. But you have to go to the servicing center, and they are going to replace that port. Okay, for him. And after replacing, you will get a proper operation of those devices. All right.
Okay, sir. It is repairable. Okay.
Right. It is repairable. Yes. You can even change it. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Anything else from this chapter, from this lecture? Would you like to know?
What is cash and cookies?
I think not. Okay, everything is clear to you.
So what type of question will come in our exam from this chapter?
In your lab course, I'm going to basically set your question in such a way so that you need not to write anything. Okay. What you have to do? Can you guys hear me properly?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So as I'm mentioning, in your lab course, you need not to write down anything. What you have to do, you have to work with your computer. You have to perform practical work. Okay. So suppose if I say that search an information, okay, from Google. Like I'm saying that, okay, who is the richest person in the world in 2020. I need this information. So search it through Google and give me that information. This is your question. Okay. So what you have to do? You have to open your web browser first. Then you have to type your google.com in the address bar. Then you have to search that information through your Google search engine. Isn't it? So you have to know what is the use of web browser. Okay. That is the thing. Directly, you're not going to get this type of question. What is web browser? Write down different names of web browser. In your theory course, you might get this type of question, but lab course, you're not going to get this type of question. Okay, that is the thing. If I say that you have to send me an email, so what you have to do? At first, you have to open your web browser. Okay, then you have to type gmail.com, isn't it? Then you have to log into your Gmail account. So you have to know how to use web browser. If you do not know how to web browser, then you will not be able to use your Gmail account. You will not be able to surfing internet. You will not be able to search something by using Google search engine. Okay. That's why it is important to learn about this web browser. Okay. You understand my point, Tanvir?
Yes, sir.
So directly, you're not going to get question like that. What is web browser? Okay. Draw the user interface. Okay. In the Viva session, I might ask you that. Can you tell me, Tanvir, what is the name of this portion of this web browser? Suppose by showing the tab, I'm saying that, okay, what is the name of this part of this web browser? You have to say that, sir, this is the web, this is the tab. Okay, this is the minimize or maximize option. Or from this point, we can close my web browser. All right. So in the Viva session, I might ask you this type of question. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I think you guys are very clear about it. So what do you say? Should I start the next lecture?
Sir, maybe leave us
sure,
today.
Sir.
Sure.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Sure. Okay, I'm getting basically mixed opinion. Some of you are some of you are like to leave. Okay.
Many of us like to leave, but no one is talking.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir. All right.
After lunch, class, now it's raining. It's very sleepy weather, sir.
True. It's true. Very true. I really agree with you. I have no different opinion. Okay. Yes, but let's see, at least let's see what we have inside the second lecture. Okay. So I'm not going to, discuss anything from that part. I'm just going to make you familiar. Okay, what we have inside the lecture. Okay. Okay, let us explore it.
Thank you, sir.
So let's see. Can I go see the lecture number 2? On your
yes, sir.
All right. So what is the title of the lecture?
How to search on Google.
Search information.
Search information on internet.
On internet, right. Okay. That means we are going to learn how we can search any information through search
on internet.
Okay. Through search engine in the internet, right. And here, we have different types of search engine, okay, like Google search engine, we have Bing, we have Yahoo, but now in this course we're going to discuss about Google search engine, okay. And at first we're going to learn about what is information, okay, different forms of information. You already know what is information, okay. So we're going to learn different forms of information, okay. So then why people need information, source of information, search engine and searching option in Google. Start with simple search, voice search, quick, how to get quick answer, then search, punctuation mark, symbol and operator, advanced searching, image search on Google and search by image, video searching on Google. Okay, some of you might think that, okay sir, I already know about this thing, okay, we already know how to search something on Google, this is very easy, okay, we have to go to Google. We have to write down in the address bar, we have to write down www.google.com. It will show me the search bar. Then whatever the keyword I would like to search, I have to write down the keyword inside that search bar. If I press enter, it will show me the number of links. Okay. Many of you thinking like that, but we have many things. Okay. We can learn from here. Many advanced things we have. Like, do you guys have any idea about advanced search in Google? Anyone? How we can do advanced search?
Yes, sir. I think I know a little bit.
Okay, right. So yes, we are going to explore many things about this advanced search. Okay. Then we can search Google in three ways. Like you can search by typing text. You can give instruction to your computer. Okay. By your voice, through your voice, or you can search by picture. Okay. You can search even by picture. These three ways we can search, but most of the cases we use text searching, isn't it? Text searching, but sometimes we do not have any idea how to give comment through our voice, isn't it? Okay. So let me show you one thing. Suppose. I'm sharing one thing with you. Okay, so can you guys see my mobile screen?
Yes, sir.
So it is not that much clear. Okay. So here we have a speaker option, isn't it? In your basically mobile phone, in the browser, you will get on speaker option. Okay. If I press the speaker, okay, then now it is telling me that it is listening, I have to say something. Okay. So I can give voice comment. Okay. So suppose if I say, what is the capital of Dhaka?
So what is the capital of Dhaka?
Capital of Bangladesh.
Sir, Bangladesh.
Right. I am basically telling that what is the capital of Dhaka? And south central part of the country. This artificial intelligence giving me information. Dhaka is not, I mean, there is no capital of Dhaka. What I have to do? They are saying that there is no capital of Dhaka. Okay. Dhaka is the capital of Bangladesh and it is giving information about Dhaka. Okay, that is the thing. Suppose if I say, what is the capital of Australia?
Canberra is the capital of Australia.
Can you listen? Canberra. Can you hear? What it is saying?
Yes, sir.
If I say that,
I can hear you.
M.M. Rakibul Hasan. Okay, let me try with my name. Is there any output I get or not? M.M. Rakibul Hasan. Okay, it is very close, but you have to be careful about your pronunciation, basically. Okay. What is the capital of India?
New Delhi is the capital of India.
You see? So in this way, you can give voice search. Okay. And automatically, Google will tell you, your answer. Okay. It will show you the links as well as it will show you the, it will give, through voice, it will give you the information as well. Okay. So we can text through text, we can search through voice, we can search even through uploading emails also we can search. Okay. Through uploading emails, you can also search. Okay. So many advanced thing we have in this Google. Okay. We're going to learn in our second lecture. Am I clear to you? And I believe that you're going to find out that lesson very interesting. Okay. In our next week, we're going to learn about this search, how we can do advanced search through Google search engine. All right.
Can you give us a little example of advanced search?
Okay. Let me share my screen. Give me a moment. I'm sharing my screen with you.
Okay, sir.
Okay, let me know whether you can see my screen or not. Web browser.
Yes, sir. I can see.
All right. Yes, sir. So here, if I write down this URL, www.images.google.com. Okay, images.google.com. And if I enter, it might take a few seconds. Okay, now can you see one camera icon here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so suppose I would like to search some image. Okay, suppose if I click here, then you can paste any URL of your image, or you can upload any image from your device, which is stored inside your computer. I'm choosing one picture from my device. Suppose if I search this picture. Okay, it is loading. Let's see whether they can recognize this one or not. Can you see? It is telling that this is a cow, and it is giving information about this cow. Okay, and other information about that image. Can you see that? Okay, so in this way, what you can do, you can search any picture. Okay, through picture, you can also search. If any picture is unknown to you, you can upload it, and Google search engine going to provide you information about that picture. Okay, that is the thing. Suppose here we have Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Somehow my connection broken here because of internet problem. Okay, as I'm saying, so there are some other options as well, okay, for advanced searching in Google. Like, let me show you another URL. Just a minute. I'm sharing my screen again with you. So if I write down here www.google.com/advanced_image_search, okay, if I give enter, then it will not give me traditional home page or search page of the Google. It will give me this interface, and from here I can select my picture. More specific information I can select. Okay, like if you want, you can write down your keyword. Okay, then if you can add some phrase, other phrase, okay, other word you can add here. Okay, if you want to download any specific image size, from here you can select. Okay, then you can select the ratio of the picture. Okay, then you can select any color. Suppose I would like to download any black and white picture of computer. Okay, then you can select the type of the image. Okay, which type you would like to download. You can select the region. Okay, that means that picture uploaded by which, from which country. Okay, you can select any specific domain, specific website name. Other information you also download, like if you want JPG image or PNG image, or what type of image you would like to select. Okay, download. Okay, so in this way you can fill up this information, and if you click on advanced search, okay, can you see it is showing only black and white computer images, not other color. Okay, as I have selected black and white. Okay, so in this way we can perform some advanced search. Okay, so there are many more things here. Okay, so from here, okay, here you get the tools option. From here again you can select the size. Okay, if I make it medium, it will show me only the medium pictures. Okay, if I would like to select suppose red, okay, it will show me only the red color computers. Okay, you can see the right, that means copyright issue. If someone has copyright on a specific picture, you cannot modify it. Okay, so from here you can find out which picture is free. Okay, then you can select the type. Okay, you can select the time, like uploaded last 24 hours, and which picture uploaded last 24 hours, and a recent picture you can get, past week, past month, past year. Okay, in this way you can select. And again, from here you can clear all the filters. Okay, you can clear all the filters, then it will see general images again. Okay, all right, so this type of things you can do. Okay, so these type of things we are going to learn in our next class. I think you are clear, isn't it, what we are going to do in our next lab class?
Yes sir.
All right, thank you.
Yes sir,
for your response. Now I would like to check your attendance. Okay,
thank you sir.
So response your name please. Dipannita.
Yes sir.
All right, Dipannita present. Then Nurul Afsar.
Yes sir.
Saqib Raidul Islam. Saqib, still he is absent. Then Shaun Sarkar, Shaun present. Then Tasnia Shifa. Tasnia, are you present?
Sir.
Right. Then Shaju, are you present? Shaju is not present. Then Arif Mahmood.
Yes, sir.
Arif present. Ritu.
Yes, sir.
Mashfi. I saw Mashfi. Samin.
Present, sir.
Samin present. Then Sabir Hassan.
Present, sir.
Anunna Ahmed.
Present, sir.
Tanvir Ahmed Khan.
Present, sir.
Rimu.
Present, sir.
Ihan. Dihan. Okay, then
present at the end.
Yes, sir.
Then Al Amin Akash.
Present, sir.
Dhruvo.
Yes, sir.
Sifat.
Present.
Raihan. Raihan Mahmood. Raihan is not present. Then Dolon.
Yes,
she is having electricity issue in his area. There is no electricity in his area from the morning.
All right. Najmus Sakib. Najmus Sakib. Okay. So in today's class, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sakib, Shaju, Dihan, Raihan, Najmus Sakib, and Dolon, she has electricity issue. Okay. All right. Okay. I told you that in our today's class, I'm going to discuss about the role of course leader. Okay. So, right, we have only seven minutes left for our class. So let me quickly discuss about the role of course leader. As a course leader, basically you have to always connected with me if I need to give any update, if I need to circulate any information, okay, to all of your friends, you have to circulate that one. Okay, then if there is any change in the class schedule, okay, class taking procedure, class taking method, that person is going to track it down and provide the information to others. As well as a course leader, you have to play a role as, record keeper. You have to keep some recorded, okay, and you have to maintain some record as well, okay. And those who will be selected as a course leader, I'm going to talk with that person separately and explain what the other is.
Anyone here?
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
I can hear you guys. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Now I can hear you.
Okay.
Now I can hear, sir.
Okay, all right. So I'm going to explain everything. I'm going to talk about that person and I'm going to explain everything about that person, about the role of course leader to that person. Okay. But now I would like to know, floor is open. Is there anyone willing to be a course leader in this, for this course? Is there anyone willing to be course leader?
Sir, I am not clear about the duty of course leader.
So yes, sir, me too. Selected, if you are selected as a course leader,
the network issue, I can't hear you properly. That's why I can't be clear.
Can you guys hear me now properly?
Now I can hear you, sir.
Okay. No. I'm saying that if you are selected as course leader, I'm going to explain everything with to you, okay, separately, okay, what you have to do. But usually you have to manage the class, you have to communicate with me for different issue, you have to track down different information regarding the class, okay. Sometimes you need to communicate with your friends, okay, and class friends, okay. These are the things you have to do as a course leader. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So is there anyone willing to be the course leader for this course?
Yes, sir. Me. I want to be the course leader.
Okay. But as it is, our country is basically what?
Pratjatantri Bangladesh.
All right.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay. Okay. People's Republic of Bangladesh, isn't it? Okay. People. So sir, people's, I would like Republic. To know from to you guys, do you guys have any, different opinion? Okay. Are you allowed, Tanvir, to be your course leader? I'm going to see him next 7 days. If his performance is satisfactory, then I'm going to continue work with him. Otherwise, I'm going to change Tanvir. Okay.
Okay, sir.
What do you guys say? Are you okay with him?
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm definitely okay.
Okay, all right. Okay. So congratulations, Tanvir. Okay. You are going to play a role as a course leader. Okay,
and thank you, sir.
We believe that we are going to get, very cooperation, okay, full service from you, okay, as a teacher and as a classmate, your friends, they are going to get full support from you.
Sure, sir.
Congratulations, Tanvir.
Okay, congratulations, Tanvir.
Congratulations. Okay. Thank you, sir.
You can feed us some sweet, okay, distribute some sweet to
or
us.
Or biryani.
Okay, all right. Then next, Tanvir will say that, no, sir, I'm not going to play a role as course leader. Okay. So maybe when we meet physically in the campus, on that time, Tanvir can give us a treat. What do you say, Tanvir?
Yes, sir.
I can send some emojis.
No. You have to give us some treat. Okay. When university will open physically. Okay. That is the thing. All right. I'm just kidding, Tanvir. Don't be afraid. Okay. That is the thing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And as a leader, you should have a big heart. Okay. The person sure. who does not have big heart, that person will not be able to be a leader. Okay. That is the thing. This is the first criteria. You have to have courage. Okay. That is the thing.
Okay, sir.
Okay. All right. So, guys, thank you for participating in the class. Okay. We have only 2 minutes left. So, I would like to adjourn the class for now. So, see you in the next week. But tomorrow we have a theory class. Okay.
Yes, sir.
But regarding lab class, sir. See you in the next week. Okay. And I believe that you are going to practice everything what we learned in this class. And let me know if you have any problem regarding this class or not. All right.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Sir. Thank you, everyone. Yes,
thank okay. you, sir.
Have a
thank
good you, day. So, sir. See you tomorrow. See you next week. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Assalamualaikum. Sir, who is the convener and the rapporteur?
I'm going to select next class okay. immediately. Okay. There will be no okay, predefined. Sir. All of you have to play role as convener and rapporteur. All right.
Okay, sir.
All right. All thank right. you.
Okay. Assalamualaikum. Allah.